animals and cruelty and neglect issues. And the questions were coming in about, well, you know, why can't you just take the animals and what do you have to do and things like that. So I put a little note out on our volunteer Facebook page saying, is anybody interested in this topic? And it was a really big response. So then I put a note out on my personal page saying, is anyone interested in this topic? Because it might be kind of big. And sure enough, look at y'all, it's big. So this is really great. It's very exciting to be here and have all of our panelists here. So I'm gonna turn it over to Scott Wilson. And Scott, when you're done, Haley and Carla, okay.
Thank you, Liz. Can everyone hear me or do I need the microphone?
No.
I'm known for loud and obnoxious. I'll try to get rid of the obnoxious today, but am I loud enough or do I need the mic?
Yes, you're good.
You're good.
Let me ask our folks from public television, can you hear me okay? Cool. We'll skip the microphone then. Give it to someone more deserving.
I probably won't need it either.
Sure.
No, when you really feel good about something, you can use your voice, right?
Okay, give me half a second to get this up and running. As Liz said, my name is Scott Wilson. I'm with the Animal Rescue League of Iowa as our Animal Welfare Intervention Coordinator. Big, long job titles usually mean you don't do a lot. That is not true with me. My job involves a couple of facets. One is being a conduit between citizens of Iowa and local law enforcement or regulatory agencies on animal welfare issues. There are a lot of people who don't understand who to contact in animal welfare issues, how to go about contacting, what information is needed. I'm there to act as a conduit between the two of them. Additionally, I'm a technical resource for law enforcement. I'll tell you right now, most sheriff's departments are overwhelmed in this state. Animal welfare investigations are very complex, and they honestly don't have the time or resources to learn everything there is about it. So I become their encyclopedia. I do what I can to help them out with anything from developing their case to seizure of animals to rehoming them once the court makes disposition. Let's see. In 2017, my office, we dealt with 233 intervention cases around the state of Iowa. 38 of those was us on the ground assisting law enforcement somewhere in the state. And we rescued a total of 199 animals last year with the assistance of law enforcement. So what this does, this gives me a pretty unique perspective on the Iowa animal welfare laws, because I don't deal with just one jurisdiction on how they interpret them. I deal with 99 counties, seeing how the courts, law enforcement, the county attorneys are interpreting and working with these laws. Okay, the Animal Legal Defense Fund. Every year, they do a survey and ranking of the 50 states and the territories, comparing their animal welfare laws to see who's doing well and who is not doing well. For the last 5 years, Iowa has ranked 49th out of 50 states. We are better than Kentucky year after year, but other than that, every other state in the United States has better laws or using them better than we are. Some of the things that the ALDF found, our penalties are weak compared to other states. Just to give you an example, in Iowa, right now, first offense animal torture, which I think we can all agree, torture is a bad thing, is an aggravated misdemeanor. You have to be caught a second time torturing an animal in order for it to be a felony. Every state surrounding us, just about, I think there's one that doesn't, has first offense animal torture of a felony. This is unexcusable, quite honestly. We have inadequate definitions. Who can tell me, Iowa code for companion animals requires sufficient food and water and adequate shelter. Can someone tell me what adequate shelter is? Anyone. Neither can the Iowa code. They do not define what shelter is. So law enforcement is forced to make a guess when they go out on the site. The prosecutor is forced to make a guess as to what adequate shelter is when he gets to court. And the judge is forced to guess what he thinks adequate shelter is. Some judges think a cardboard box next to a tree is adequate shelter. Others don't. There's too much leeway in it. We've had cases where people have thrown food out, you know, from the night before to their dogs or cats, and that's adequate food. It's not. It's not designed for dogs and cats. It's not clean. It's not wholesome. But the law doesn't say anything about that. Another place we really lack, there are no restrictions on future ownership for someone convicted of animal cruelty. The most heinous crimes, we need to get Iowa has no provision for that. There's no requirement in Iowa for any sort of psychological counseling except in the case of torture. So if you abuse an animal or you let an animal, you know, suffer without shelter and it dies, well, you must be okay, you don't need any help. A lot of these problems can be nipped in the bud if we get to them early, get them psychological counseling, find out what the issues are, and get them fixed. I'm going to go over a couple of cases in the last couple of years or so in Iowa that really show why our laws are bad. How many of you remember the no-kill rescue in Sandyville, Iowa? Yeah, we ended up removing 19 live dogs and 3 deceased dogs from several properties that she had access to. She was charged with animal torture, which unfortunately by the definition of the law right now, they couldn't sustain, so they had to drop that. She ended up pleading guilty to 22 counts of animal neglect. She was sentenced to 1,665 days in jail. She served 7 days. Everything else was suspended. After letting 3 dogs die, 1 dog get torn apart by pit bulls and barely surviving, that is what she got in a fine. There's no mental health follow-up on this. She's obviously a hoarder. She had all these animals crammed into filthy conditions in the house. There's no keeping her from having additional pets. Nothing was done but give her a fine and 7 days in jail. Talking about this last year, Suzette Stalker. Police impounded 13 neglected cats and 5 neglected dogs from the address. She entered a guilty plea to 1 count of animal neglect and was given a $315 fine. She has been charged with animal cruelty in 2012, 2008, and 2008 again. If in any of these cases they have assigned psychological counseling to her, we might not have had this 2017 case. Statistically speaking, animal hoarders have an almost 100% recidivism rate if they're not treated. So we've got to do something besides giving them a small fine and letting them go on their way. Sarah McMiniman in Ames, Iowa. You may have seen this story. She took her dog to the vet. They thought it had an obstruction in the intestines. So she took it home and used a paring knife and a set of kitchen tongs to try to clear the obstruction. She ended up killing the dog. She thought it was okay because she was brought up castrating pigs on the farm, so she was obviously a surgical veterinarian. She was charged with animal neglect causing death or serious injury, which was the most severe charge that could be applied to her, animal neglect for cutting open her dog and letting it die. She was sentenced to 1 year in jail, once again, 1 year suspended. She was given a year of probation and a $315 fine. Again, no follow-up, no keeping her from having pets in the future, no psychological evaluation of this sort of case. It's going to repeat itself. This one's from Des Moines in 2015. Keegan Buckland was recorded on a videotape by a neighbor's house with his pit bull outside, hitting it, kicking it, throwing it to the ground for about 5 minutes. The only thing they could get him with, since there wasn't any permanent injury or death to the pit bull, was animal neglect, which is a simple misdemeanor. He couldn't be charged for animal abuse, because in this state right now, you cannot abuse your pet, even though it's a more severe crime. Someone else can abuse your pet, but you can't. So prosecutors are given animal neglect or animal torture. There's no middle ground. Last case I'm going to bring up, I hope this is the last one because I've got a limited amount of time. Roger Blue, Drakesville, Iowa, 2014. The Animal Rescue League removed over 300 neglected animals from this property. He was charged with 28 counts of animal neglect. He did a plea deal. He got a 1 year jail sentence with all the 10 days that he'd already served in jail suspended. And he agreed not to possess any animals for an indefinite period. Before he was even sentenced, he moved across the border into Missouri and started recollecting pets. He ended up with, I believe, 85 when the Humane Society of Missouri and a county sheriff's office down there removed the animals. At that point, he was hit with 2 felony counts of animal neglect because of the previous conviction. But once again, no psychological counseling, no follow-up on him. He was free to do what he wanted to again. So what are we looking at in Iowa? What is our problem? We took it upon ourselves to look at some model ordinances, model statutes, and what other states are doing, not reinventing the wheel. We've had a bad problem the last few years with this legislation, stalled in subcommittee because we're not getting a lot of support from the grassroots folks. People come to these meetings and say, yes, I'm concerned, but But when we send out a notice saying there's a vote coming up, the senators and representatives get one, maybe two phone calls from people supporting the bill, and five or six from commercial breeders or farmers who are afraid the bill is going to impact them. So they've got a groundswell against the bill and they vote against it. So we decided it's time for a big picture approach. The entire 717B is flawed, and it needs to be pretty well completely scrapped and revamped. So like I said, we looked around, looked at all the top states in the country, looked at some model laws, and put together what we think is a very good legal package. So what are we going to do with this law? What's proposed under, and you'll see it in the paperwork, it says SF-421. That number's been changed if you happen to contact your representative. It's now SF-2181, so it no longer exists. But we're improving definitions. We want to define especially what injury and serious injury are, you know, to really give an idea of what the severity of the case is. We want to redefine the definition of neglect so that that's an omission to provide care. It doesn't involve beating, stomping, kicking animals. It's failure to provide a standard of care. Abuse is a more active role. You're doing something physically to harm the animal, which isn't the case now. We want to remove that silly exemption that says an owner cannot abuse their own animals. That is ridiculous, and we don't know why it's there, but we want it out of there. And we want to improve the definitions for the basic standard of care for dogs and cats and other companion animals. What is shelter? What is food? What is water? Instead of making everyone involved with this guess as to what they are, let's tell them what it is and let them enforce it. It will make their jobs a lot easier. We want to enhance the penalties, especially if the person is a repeat offender. Right now, that doesn't apply except for animal torture. If you've been convicted before for animal neglect, and you just go right back out and neglect another animal, it shouldn't just be a simple little misdemeanor. It should be enhanced because you didn't get the message the first time. If you commit torture of an animal and you've previously been convicted of animal abuse, you obviously have an issue, and it should be more serious. We want to provide for mental health evaluations for the more heinous crimes. Someone leaving a dog outside for several hours without water, the dog suffers no damage, we're not going to make them go through a psychological evaluation. But people who intentionally harm animals or neglect them to the point where they die need to be treated. And finally, we want to create a crime of animal endangerment. Right now, there is no law in Iowa that really says you can't leave a dog or cat in a hot car. It falls under other sections, but law enforcement really doesn't have an affirmative direction as to how to rescue animals in hot cars. And we've had law enforcement say, yeah, the animal's in the car, we can't go into it, we don't have the authority. We want to fix that problem right there. That's a common theme every year, summer-wide across Iowa. Okay, this is more than just putting people in jail. Jail is not going to happen except for the worst crimes, honestly, in the state. But we do want the penalties to be increased so that county attorneys, judges, know that animal cruelty is a crime. This is not just something that happens. This is a serious crime. We want to get these people mental health assistance. A majority of these offenders are not serial killers. They're not psychopaths. They have mental issues that need. We want to protect future animals, so we want to put restrictions in place for possession. If you've had a problem, you need to get that problem fixed before you start owning more animals. And I think I've just discussed the other two issues, but a lot of this is still going to depend on the prosecutors and judges. One thing we hear back from a lot of legislators is, why increase the penalties if the judges aren't using the current penalties? And it's a valid argument. But the question is, in that case, let's drop all penalties for all these crimes that aren't getting jail time or anything. You know, if you assault somebody, oh, let's just make it a fine. Why put people in, you know, possibly in jail? We want to give the courts the tools to adequately deal with these questions. Whether they deal with them or not is up to the court, but we at least want to give them the proper tools. So what have we been doing? Last 5 years, I've been driving across the state every fall into the early spring, generating grassroots support. Talking to major stakeholders, sheriff's departments, county attorneys, citizens groups like this, trying to get backing for this bill. We've been meeting with key legislators. I've been spending more time at the state capitol this month than I have in my office, trying to get their support of this bill. We've worked with couple of key legislators drafted this wording about 4 years ago, 5 years ago now. It's been improved a little bit since, but we're still working with these key legislators getting their support on this. The bill was reintroduced this last year after it got shut down. It's currently SF-2181 in the Senate, and it is right now calendared for the full Senate floor. It's gone through all the subcommittees it needs to. On the House side, the House bill, which is exactly the same, is HSB 608, and this got out of the Judiciary Subcommittee this last week. So it goes to the Judiciary Committee, hopefully within the next week, and then gets passed on to the full floor. This will be the first time we've gotten a full vote of the House and Senate on this bill in 5 years. So what can you do? We have to have people's help. We need concerned citizens, which I'm assuming you all are since you're here on a snowy Saturday morning, afternoon. We need to be willing to step forward and take action. First step, get to know your legislators. If you have not met your senator or representative, next time you come into town for a steak fry or a Rotary Club meeting or something, introduce yourself. They're more likely to respond to you if they know your face and name. Let them know that this issue is important to you. Tell them, you know, Senator So, thank you so much, you know, for everything you've done in the past for Iowa. There's this bill in the Senate coming through. It's really an important bill. Here are the two or three basic ideas. Please support it. Be appreciative. Be thankful. How many of you know Senator King? How many of you think he is an advocate for animal welfare? Yeah, I will tell you, I personally had to talk to him. I had to find good things he's done that I can agree with in Iowa. It may not be easy every time with every representative, but you've got to find common ground with them. You cannot go into this combatively. Find what they've done, express your opinion, thank them for their service, even if you don't like them. Attend our Humane Lobby Day. Every year, ARL and several other organizations hold a lobby day at the state capitol where we'll talk to you about the issues, give you a little handout on some of the key points, and show you where your representatives or senators' offices are. They know you're going to be there. They're sitting there. They give you 5 minutes of their time so you can express your opinion about these bills. Come and do it. It will be on the 20th of February from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. This is a great opportunity to get some one-on-one time with your representatives and let them know what's important to you. You can contact us if you have any ideas about the laws. The laws are available online. And also, while you're online, go to our Facebook page for the Humane Action Network and sign up, because we will put you on a mailing list when there are alerts coming up. But there's a key vote coming up where we need you to call right now. And honestly, the way state government works, sometimes we get 2 hours notice that a bill is coming up for a vote. So we'll send out an email or a text message saying, this bill is coming up. Please contact your representative now. Let them know it's important. We're not going to sell it to anyone. You're not going to be getting calls from Pella Windows. But we need immediate action, so definitely sign up for alerts. What we need, though, is everyone. There are a lot of people who are against this bill. We need as much support as we can to get it through. All right, and I think we're going to take questions later.
Yeah, I think we'll do the presentations, and then we'll take questions at the end. So if you're thinking a question in your head, write it down. Or
remember this slide. We'll have questions later. Thank you very much.
I'm Haley Anderson. I am the Executive Director of Iowa Voters for Companion Animals and Iowa Friends of Companion Animals. And we have two organizations, obviously, with one primary goal, which is to advance the humane and responsible treatment. Can you hear? Do I need to speak up? Do I need the microphone?
There you go.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Two organizations, one overall goal, to advance the humane and responsible treatment of companion animals in Iowa. Primarily, we focus on
commercial dog breeding, primarily with puppy mills. So why do we have two organizations? Since everyone is here to discuss laws and regulations, I'll just let you know. It's primarily due to IRS regulations. So 501c3 organizations are fantastic. However, the IRS limits their lobbying ability. So we have a 501c4, Iowa Voters, so we can have unlimited lobbying access at the Capitol. Fantastic for me. This is why we focus on puppy mills, right? So bear with me because we're here to discuss laws and regulations. It's gonna get a little tedious when we get into the laws. But when we discuss statistics and numbers, we also have to remember these are individual animals behind all of these numbers. This is one example of a dog in a puppy mill. I think we're all pretty much educated in this room, I'm going to assume, on puppy mills and the conditions within them, the lack of vet care, socialization, genetic issues, and studies that have proven that not only do adult breeding dogs within these facilities obviously suffer traumatic, inhumane, cruel conditions, but the puppies coming out of these facilities are also often suffering lifelong behavioral and health issues due to where they're born and raised. So this is the state of Iowa, and all those little yellow dots are a commercial dog breeding facility. So clearly this is an Iowa issue. This isn't one county, one district, one city. This is an Iowa issue, it's all of our issue, and it's all of our legislators' issue as well. So where do we stand right now in Iowa as far as dog breeding? We are number 4 in the nation. We have 250, just over 250 federally licensed breeders and dealers, and approximately 15,000 adult breeding dogs within these facilities. 2016 USDA statistics have shown that 46 of these kennels house more than 100 adult dogs. I have one dog. He's plenty for me. 100 dogs, caring for 100 dogs, I think we can already assume there's some issues there. And 53% of the breeders and dealers in 2015 were cited for violating the Animal Welfare Act. Okay, so we have two different kind of licensees in Iowa, federally licensed and state licensed. I'm going to give you kind of a brief overview of what that means, because I know in our communications we discuss that quite a bit, and I just want everyone to kind of have a general knowledge of what that means. So we focus primarily on the federally licensed commercial dog breeding facilities because these are the most problematic, they have the most dogs, we can do the most good in these situations. So if you have these things, if you're doing these things, you would need to be federally licensed. So 5 or more breeding females and selling dogs sight unseen where they're raised on the premises. 5 or more breeding females that are distributed to retail pet stores. Selling dogs for research. Many breeding facilities are selling dogs for research. That's also a primary driver behind puppy mills. They have to sell 25 or more. And selling any dog that's not born and raised on your property for research. So the federally licensed breeders here in Iowa are regulated by the United States Department of Agriculture, USDA, their Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service. So it's USDA APHIS. And animal care is under APHIS. They perform the inspections, and they are the ones that enforce the Animal Welfare Act. The breeders are then regulated by the Animal Welfare Act. So what is the Animal Welfare Act? It's basically regulating the transportation, purchase, sale, housing, care, handling, treatment, animals and research, exhibitions, and pets. So it includes dog breeders, zoos, circuses, research facilities. It was enacted into law in 1966. The primary driver behind it was a pet dog. So Pepper the Dalmatian went missing. She was actually stolen and sold to a research facility. Her family searched and searched for her. Unfortunately, when they found her, she had been sold to a New York research facility and passed away due to the experiments on her. So that's why the Animal Welfare Act came into practice. In 1966, we didn't have the large-scale dog breeding industry like we do today. There wasn't the puppy mill issue. So these regulations are really inadequate to deal with the problems we're seeing. We don't have enough time, nor I'm sure you do, you want me to read through all of the regulations within the Animal Welfare Act, so I'm just going to give you a couple examples of why it's concerning. The minimum standards of care are really minimum standards of survival. I believe everyone in here would not want their dog to be stuck in a cage that's 6 inches behind and above, for primarily their entire life. That's just not really good well-being for your dog. This is okay under the Animal Welfare Act. This would be in compliance. So the other important thing, it gets tedious, right, about laws and the language and what does that mean, but it's so critical. So there are standards of care for temperature. So for internal housing, external housing, and this for moving or traveling. So this says the ambient temperature in mobile or traveling housing facility must not fall below 50 degrees for dogs and cats not acclimated to lower temperatures for those breeds that cannot tolerate lower temperatures for sick, aged, young, or infirm dogs and cats. So that sounds fairly reasonable, right? But okay, so that would be a fairly decent regulation and protection. However, when a dog is transported or sold across state lines, there needs to be a certificate of veterinary inspection, or a CVI. So this is an example of a CVI. You can see at the bottom, acclimated to 0 degrees to 99 degrees. So this is an 8-week-old lab puppy sold from Iowa to California. And the vet has signed off to say that the temperature is okay for this puppy to be 0 degrees up to 99 degrees. That is shocking, right? That's really not okay. And obviously we are concerned about that. So these inspections happen for kennels. The USVA is to inspect once per year all the kennels. If there's an issue, they will inspect again. Often breeders are given chance after chance after chance, teachable moments that aren't even really a non-compliance issue. A non-compliance issue basically means a violation of the Animal Welfare Act, but inspectors are not allowed to determine if it's a violation. It's only a judge that can determine if it's a violation. So they get educational moments, chances to improve, then they have a non-compliance issue, chances to improve, and it takes a really long time for action really to be taken to improve conditions within, particularly the most concerning facilities. So here you can see this is 2015 data, the percentages of violations by category. So housing, access, vet care, cleaning, pest control, these are all very concerning non-compliance and violation issues. Okay, so now that was federal. Now what about states? We have state licensees as well. And that is regulated by Iowa Department of Agriculture and Land Stewardship, or IDOLS. This is required if you have 4 or more breeding dogs over 12 months of age and are advertising dogs or puppies for sale. So if you have this in your home, you should be state licensed. These are governed by the Iowa Code, Chapter 162, Care of Animals in Commercial Establishments, and Iowa Code, Chapter 67, Animal Welfare. So we have hurdles in both federal and state licensees. What are our primary hurdles? Well, the inspections, right, and allowing non-compliance and violations to build up and years of repeated violations, that's a definite concern. That's a federal issue that we need to take on as a state. The other federal issue is our own jurisdiction. If we go to a local sheriff and say there's an issue with a federally licensed commercial dog breeder in your area, they will oftentimes say it's a USDA federal issue. It's not our problem. We're not touching it. Contact the USDA. That's obviously more difficult for us to deal with in Iowa than to be working with our local enforcement or IDOLS. And counties really don't have a lot of the adequate resources to take care of these, particularly larger, major problem dog breeders. So if I were to go to a county attorney and sheriff and say there's a dog breeder with 150 dogs, what if those dogs need to be seized? What if they do need vet care? Who's going to pay for that? Who's going to take in these dogs? Do most counties have those resources available to them? And do they know how to do that? Do they know who to contact? Do they know how to handle that? That's a major hurdle for us as well. And agricultural interests. We are always given the excuse of the slippery slope. Scott touched on it a little bit. With any legislation, any agricultural interest will say is a slippery slope. First you want to regulate dog breeding, and then you want to regulate our pigs and our cattle and our chickens. And they pretty much kind of wash their hands of it. The American Kennel Club is also one of our opponents. Many people are surprised about this, right? They should be supporting happy and healthy dogs. If you go onto their website and look at their advocacy and legislative priorities, you will see where their priorities lie. They often come out against legislation that we propose. And the USDA blackout is definitely a hurdle for us now. I'm assuming most have heard about this. The USDA pulled tens of thousands of records from a public database that allowed us to go in and look at these inspection reports so we could monitor, that we could file complaints, we could ring the alarm if there was something serious going on. Much of that information is now unavailable, not only to us as a watchdog organization, but to you all. So we obviously push adoption first, if you want to have a new puppy or a new dog. If that's not possible, find a reputable breeder, one that will let you come to their house, see the dog, see where they're raised, see the mother and the father. Right now, how do you find out who is a reputable breeder and who is a puppy mill operator if you cannot access inspection reports? Can't. So this is an example of a few pages of a normal kind of inspection report. This isn't even really one of the most concerning ones, but you can see there's wording there that kind of gives a description of what the concern was, what the non-compliance issue was, and pictures and video if need be. So there you can see there's an issue with her eye, and you can see the cages behind in this other picture. That's often what puppy mills look like, right? It's a raised wire caging for all these dogs. And this particular breeder has upwards of 500 dogs. This is an inspection report from 2017. So this is kind of a normal inspection report that we would be able to get information and take action on. This is what we're getting now. And I have to give a shout out to Tracy. Tracy has been one of our fantastic volunteers and data queen. She has compiled most of our data and has led a FOIA team. So the USDA's response to a lawsuit saying we need those records, they need to be public records, was you can get all this information via FOIA, Freedom of Information Act submission. Privacy concerns for the breeders take priority. So we said, okay, Tracy led a fantastic team, some of who are in the room. Ooh, thank you, shout out. To file these FOIA so we could actually get submission, we could submit them and get actual data. We submitted over 400, and 90% of what we received back, which takes months, over 6 months to get anything back, looks like this. They have reinstated some information, but oftentimes it still looks like this, or the actual kennel name is redacted now. So you can't even see what kennel it is. Yep, big hurdle for us. So what do we propose, right? We have all these hurdles, we know there's an issue, what can we do about that? We really want state oversight for these federally licensed breeders and dealers. It would allow us to deal with them more on a state level. It would take away that excuse that it's a federal issue, it's USDA, we can't touch it. It would allow us to work with our local law enforcement better and adults. Adjusting licensing fees, right now there's a flat fee, particularly with renewals. Regardless of how many dogs you have, what your revenue is, it's still $175. And the creation of a remediation fund. So if dogs do need to be rescued, if there does need to be more inspectors hired, this would give us the financial resources to do that, or IDOLs, the financial resources to do that. So we also have a bill at the Capitol right now. It's House File 454. I'm going to review it very quickly. It has been assigned to the Agriculture Committee in the House, which means we have no hope that this will go anywhere. So we have a bill, we are proposing something, they basically killed it before it even was up for discussion. But it would allow for the state oversight and compliance, so before you would be able to renew, you would have to show that you're in compliance. If you're in violation of the Animal Welfare Act or our state code, you would not be able to continue, which is happening now. It's basically a rubber stamp situation. You just keep renewing no matter what your previous history has been. Inspections would be once per year. It changes the language just a little bit from may inspect to shall inspect. And it would require reporting violations of our current code that Scott touched on, 717B, to local authorities, which now doesn't really happen. Again, adjusting those licensing fees. Right now it's standard 175, whether you have 20 dogs or 500. So an update for pet shops and commercial breeders, that 175 plus an additional fee based on the number of animals that you have. And that would fund the remediation fund and allow financial resources to better care for the inspectors, the dogs, and if they do need to be rescued. So what can we do, right? We know our bill is not really going anywhere. We are actively supporting ARL's bill. That one has the most chance of going anywhere. Again, I'm gonna repeat what Scott said. We need all of you. We can go up there, we can talk to legislators. If you've already talked to them, if they know their constituent cares, it makes a huge impact. even when I just have a conversation with them, or Scott has a conversation with them, their constituents matter to them. You are their people. We're supposed to be working together in partnership in our communities to make them a better place. They have the power to change the laws. They have the power to better protect our companion animals. They could be passing legislation and getting it done, no problem. We also have the power to elect them. Whether they care about companion animals or dogs, most of them care about re-election. So we do a scorecard every year. We'll be doing one again for this election. I encourage you to check it out and consider that when you go vote. Please go vote. And then when you, when your legislators are elected, and right now, again, as Scott said, please talk to them, get to know them, have a conversation with them. Let them know this is your concern. It needs to be consistent, it needs to be persistent, and definitely respectful, right? Yelling at someone is never going to get you anywhere, even if you are irate. So we also have updates and email alerts, so I would encourage you to sign up for those. You can go to the Iowa Voters for Companion Animals website, and there's a Take Action button. Please sign up to that. We don't inundate you. We update you on events and legislative actions and when bills come up, when to email your legislator, when to call them, when to visit with them. Again, speak to your legislators. And then again, we have Lobby Day coming up on February 20th, and we're very much excited. We're combining our lobby days this year, so it'll be us and ARL and HSUS and ASPCA and Bailing Out Benji. The organizations are coming together, and we hope advocates will come together too, because it's going to take us all.
Talking about small animals, I had bronchitis for a week, so I apologize. If you can't hear me, just raise your hand and I'll put the microphone on. But I'm just going to start off listening to these people. We have also been involved with 717 code, Iowa code 717A. A stands for agriculture. Horses fall under agriculture in the state of Iowa. B is your smaller animals. And they all need to work together for this reason. You're never going to walk onto a rescue, generally speaking, when there's horses involved that doesn't have small animals. All right, be it whatever it might be, from gerbils to dogs and cats. So this is going to be a quick rundown of laws and what we've experienced for our 15 years of rescuing horses. So this is what we do. Which has already touched on this, that we've done all 99 counties. We follow the American Association of Equine Practitioners Guide to Equine Rescue. We're certified with the state of Iowa, and we again follow Iowa Code 717A. Little history of horse cruelty in the United States. In 1832, New York campaigned for the rest, excuse me, well, you can just read this. I haven't done this for a while, so this is just really at the very beginning of history. Cruelty to horses started in 1832. That's when ASPCA got involved, that's when the Humane Society got involved, and things started happening. So, there's an estimated 100,000 unwanted horses in the United States. Slaughter plants, what causes number to go up? The slaughter plants closed in 2007, the poor economics in 2008, the drought in the West, and the depressed market of horses. So, a typical investigation. Most calls come to the Iowa Equine Rescue via concerned citizen. UC Davis study showed 82% were citizen report cases. A lot of this is going to be, this presentation is based on UC Davis. UC Davis is the known veterinarian hospital for horses in the United States. That's usually who we go to when we need DNA checked on horses that claim to be one horse and it's not, but doesn't match its papers. UC Davis is it in the horse world, in my opinion. So a lot of this is going to be referred back to them. So we screen the calls, we call the sheriff's department. Again, 70% of the calls that they receive were from law enforcement with UC Davis. So what we try to do is we try to go on and educate the owners. And we try to give them the little green pamphlet that I have up there showing that this is the minimum standards of guide for the equines in Iowa. We wrote this with Iowa State University, myself, and Animal Rescue League a few years back. So this explains the law very clearly. And we hand that to them for the beginning of a case, right? You give it to them, you talk to the people, you say, what's going on? Why are you not doing this? Here's what you should be doing. This is what should be followed by the law. This is what we suggest that you do to get your act back together. So here we go. The change to Iowa Code 717. You need to write your legislator, just like what, repeating what they're saying. The possible changes, in our opinion, to consider, again, a repeat, sorry, simple misdemeanors, or 175 to 675, does that seem true? Yeah, the serious misdemeanor is 500. Jail time with the psychological evaluation. I worked one case that this actually happened with a husband and wife. They were jailed. They had to do 8 weeks. Every other weekend they had to go to jail. And they did the psychological evaluation. They had to take classes to become better horse husbandry folks. That judge was very positive and understood why it needed to be done. 2 years later, they had another 37 horses on the property. So again, just to repeat what these people have said, it is true in the horse world as much as it is in the small animal world. We believe that three strikes are out, right? Just like anybody else and other laws that are pertain to Iowa, you've got three times to screw up. You should not have animals from that point forward. Second time offenders should be allowed to have, never be allowed to have horses again in Iowa or the nation. It's hard to do, folks. 50 states don't do it. I'm not really sure how you can tell someone you cannot have property. The biggest thing in Iowa and around the United States is horses, and at least small animals, correct me if I'm wrong, are considered property in the state of Iowa. So if a horse is a living, breathing animal, and you've got a motorcycle that lives and breathes, which it doesn't, that motorcycle can sit outside, it does whatever, it's treated as the same in the state of Iowa. Some water, sorry. My drugs are kicking in. So we believe as well that establish a state or national database of livestock or equine horse neglect and abusers. I had a fantastic meeting with ASPCA in the last month. They are starting a new equine program. They are going to, they spoke at Animal Rescue League on a Thursday night. ASPCA?
Yes.
And then we visited with them on Friday. They're really trying to change things and make things more available for the state of Iowa and all states. So that's a positive thing. They too believe that there should be a national database of neglect and abuse. And then also consider the deadbeat dads when they can't pay their fines, right? Treat them just like deadbeat dads or deadbeat moms, whatever it might be. You know, go after their money, go after their tax refunds to pay what they owe on the fees. So here we go, indicator of crime, UC Davis. 52% of the owners were already known by law enforcement. That is such a true fact. I cannot say that more than anything. If you've been there once, you've been there 10 times. 45% were previous animal neglect cases. So again, the repeat end of things. 15% were child abuse and neglect offenders. That is so sad. So you must work with all parties involved in this situation. A farm that had been under investigation for 2 years, the owners seemed to cooperate until this winter day. And we drive up and there's a dead horse in the ditch. So it's very important to get everybody that you can involved. Use as many agencies as you can. DHS for the child end of it, the health department, surrounding counties, for the fact that many people know where these people travel once they're not able to do what they're doing in that county, they'll just move to the next county or the two counties over. And they pretty well know who's who there. So, yeah, understand, there is no budget for any of this in our current situations for a small or large animal. People think of horses that, oh my gosh, it costs so much to feed, it costs so much to take care of. True. But honestly, my dog vet is more expensive than my horse vet, just FYI. So this is supporting small animals. The smaller animals can cost probably more money than a horse is. Just a pill on a horse may be that big, but it's only going to, you know, be $2 versus $5 for the same pill from a veterinarian for small animals. But, you know, you just can't say enough about offenders. All right, this situation here, we had 8 dead horses, 13 still standing. It's very important to include anyone with any authority to get involved with equine neglect and abuse. This particular case is in Chickasaw County. We had USDA, we had everybody there. And finally, it was a third time offender. We were tired of going and seeing dead horses. Nobody was doing anything about it. It was a disgusting situation. All right, it's very important to get involved. The sheriff's department is who reached out to us. We reached out then to the state vet because of everything that had happened. Oops. So, good things will happen. Good things happen to those who wait. Although things never happen as fast as we wish, the neglect and abuse doesn't usually stop overnight, and we may also follow a case for weeks, months, and years. So, rescued 2 months after investigation started. You can see the horse on the left, and now this is the horse, same horse on the right. And this horse actually won the 2003 AQHA, state of Iowa. So, rescue is rescue. All right, there's some very good stories that come out. There's some very sad stories, but you have to highlight the good that sometimes oversees the bad. Oopsie. Dang, this is touching. So, here's a 3-year situation. This horse, you can see, possibly not in this, but it has, I should bring that. I still have it. It's a chain around its neck. It had duct tape around the chain, so it wouldn't cut into the neck after 4 months of having it just a chain. All right, and this horse was put in the ditch for 3 years in Jones County. Okay? Nobody would do anything about because, one, it had water. They took out a bucket of water. And two, they would throw hay when they wanted to, or that lovely grass right there is what they said was the forage for the animal. So it took 3 years to finally get this horse removed. You can still, we didn't remove the chain yet because we didn't have, we did have bolt cutters, but anyway. Bad situation. Still waiting trial 2 months later. The reason why I'm saying this is that stuff does not happen overnight with anybody. I mean, it just doesn't happen. I mean, in legislation, in any type of a rescue, it just doesn't happen. Go get those animals, you know. So, the judge. The judge said that he would not return the animal, but needed to go to public auction. Okay, that's one of the options that you have when you get involved with rescues for horses. So, we were the ones that were chosen to take the horse to the auction. So we did this. He was still in an intact stallion. Okay, auction in Kelowna. Excuse me. You know, if you've ever been there, which I don't go there. This is the last time I was there. There's quite a few animals there, quite a few equines. And because you cannot lead, their people would not lead the stallion into the auction arena. The person that brought the animal there had to do that. That was me. Okay, which is fine. I would have been handling the horse for several months, obviously. So we get into this situation, and lo and behold, there's the owner of the horse. He's in the audience. He stands up in front of more people than in this room and says, "She stole my horse." And I'm like, "Oh my." So then the auctioneer just called and said, "Is that true?" And I said, "No, that is not true." So the long story short, we ended up with the horse. We had a bid on the horse. We won the bid. The guy was escorted away. He tried to steal the horse twice, though. And he's now passed away. Darn. Not the horse, but the owner. The horse is still thriving, so that's a good thing. So on average, a rescue will take 93 days before a hearing. 49% of the case studies were tried, 63 were tried by a judge, 26 were tried by a jury. Judgment outcome, 57% pleaded guilty, and 34% found guilty. So these are some of the eight horses that were dead. This one was actually one that lived, but she was the next one. So the reason why I like to show photos like this is that people do not realize how severe an animal can get and how, why did it have to get to this point? Why did we have to have eight horses dead on a property and 13 still alive? And that's because of the laws and people wanting to get involved and who's going to rescue them and who's going to take care of them. So this is a horse after the fact. She lived and she's doing great in Nebraska. So studies taken by the UC Davis in 2009 about horse rescues in the United States. Liz and I have had this conversation more times than none. Everybody can be a rescue. Anybody can call themselves a rescue, right? 62% of horses were cared, 62% of horses were cared and adopted out of a true horse rescue. 11% were sanctuary and retired facilities. 8% were both. And 19% were multi-animal rescues. The average equine rescue is 6 years. And this is the United States, it's not Iowa. All right, we've been with 13 years. The average horses that most rescues have are 20. The property size is generally 33 acres. The contributions, 50% are individual donations, 39% are personal funds or corporate funding. 79% of the horses that are rescued are light horses, 7% are draft, and 7% are purebred. The rest were considered other. Two-thirds of the adopters were women, 95% of them are Caucasian, and 50% were of the ages of 31 to 50. And again, this is a survey that UC Davis did. So the average cost of a horse a month is $304 for a single horse in rescue. The math, easy, you know, $3,500 a year for one horse. Services that are provided to a horse, 70% needed is parasite, hoof, vaccines, dental care. 64% were adopted to ride or drive, and 50% horses were subject to training or behavior modifications prior to adoption by the new owner. So this slide show, I hope, will at least understand the fact that it's all animals in Iowa, folks. It's not just horses. It's not just your small companion animals. That's a whole other subject on companion animals versus a horse. There are some states that have both, that horses fall under companion animals. Iowa is not like that. I talked to the gentleman that started this bill in 1964 for the egg, at 717A, and he said at that point, I doubt if that will ever change because of farmers and the agricultural world in Iowa. I hope that's not true. I would never bring a horse inside, but you never say never. But, you know, they are still very much part of people's lives and do wonderful things for people, you know, on the outside as well. So that's it for me.
Well, I don't have a PowerPoint, but I guess I'm kind of the wrap up here. And after everything we've heard from the three speakers this morning, I'm sure that some of you are sitting there just like, oh, this isn't right in Iowa. What can I do? I'm so mad. I just want to, you know, get after whoever I need to get after and get laws passed so that this kind of stuff doesn't happen either to horses or companion animals in the state. But I was asked to come here today because not so much this particular issue, but in a way it is the issue, but it's how you approach advocacy. And, you know, in my introduction,
Liz mentioned that I had been involved in advocacy for a long time, not animal advocacy, but advocacy in general, advocacy for the arts. And that's kind of where I cut my advocacy teeth, if you will. But then once I retired and a few people said, oh, you've got time on your hands, would you like to help with some issues? And I said, yes, it kind of switched over into the animal world. And a few things that I have learned, either through arts advocacy or now animal advocacy, I wanted to share with all of you today. The first thing I would ask you to do, and although it can be really, this might be the toughest thing that you have to do, that is to build a relationship with the person, with the man or the woman, who you want to help get the laws passed that you want to see passed in the state of Iowa. And I will be the first one to admit that when I started doing this, primarily on the animal end of things, because it was a little more dicey than on the arts end, the whole notion of somebody having an R or a D behind their name just set the tone right then and there. And that was one of the first things that I had to get over, and I would encourage all of you to get over, that yes, somebody belongs to a certain party, but I look at it in, my approach is this. We're all Iowans. We all live, in my case, the greater Quad City area, and we all wish for a better Iowa and a better community to live in. We have those commonalities no matter what party we belong to. And I really firmly believe if you can go into those first conversations or the second one or the third one, or maybe you've had many, many conversations with your elected official and try not to let that party thing, particularly in this particular atmosphere and time in history, get in the way, that will be a first huge step for you to get over. I try to look for commonalities with my legislators, and I do use my trump card with the fact that, no pun intended there, the fact that I grew up on a farm, that raised hogs. Yes, I castrated pigs as well and clipped their teeth and gave their shots and all that kind of stuff, and I still live on the farm. And in some instances, that is a very comforting connection to make with a legislator depending on who they are and where they're coming from. So I do use that shamelessly all the time when I'm talking to legislators, if you want to know the real truth. In Scott County and the Quad Cities, and I would kind of put the Iowa City, Cedar Rapids, North Liberty, Coralville kind of community in the same boat. Over on my in my neck of the woods, we're really fortunate that we have 4 senators and 6 House members that represent the greater Scott County area. And although some people will say, and some legislators will say, don't talk to me, you're not my constituent, you're not my my district, over in Scott County, I kind of say, nah, sorry. You all represent the county that I live in, and your decision impacts my quality of life in the Quad City. So I look at them all as fair game and have tried very hard over the last 6-7 years to build a relationship with each and every one of them. I'm not patting myself on the back with this, but I can tell you and I can share with you that I'm to the point now, more times than not, if I give them a call on the phone, I'll get a call back. I can call them in Des Moines. I can call them at home. I can send them a little email on something. I couldn't do that when I first started out trying to be a better animal advocate. It's taken a lot of time and effort on both their part and my part to build that relationship. So, again, in your neck of the woods here, I would say you've got kind of a broader, larger group of elected officials that you could call upon, and I would encourage you to build those relationships with all of them. The second thing I like to look at is making this whole thing a team approach, and again, that can be a little unsettling for people because of the adversarial assumption that we have with our elected officials, or some of them. I look at legislators as generalists. They need to know a little about, a little and enough about a subject to address an issue. But I can tell you, they are not experts in the issue that you are really concerned about. And in this case, it's animal welfare. I had one of my legislators in the Scott County tell me, I'll call her out, it's a she. She doesn't have time to read every bill. The thing that she relies on is the synopsis at the end of the bill. And that can be pretty short when you have a multi-page bill. So knowing that the time is short and they, you know, know, glom on to the very last part of the bill opens up a door for you because you know what? You're the expert in animal welfare and what you want to see done. I like to think of it my role with them to make them a more successful legislator is to provide them information. And when I provide them information anymore, this is a new little tip I've started doing with myself. I just don't say, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Legislator, I need you to do this, this, and this, and it is there. I ask them to do this, this, and this, and pose a question to them, an open-ended question, maybe looking at one of these animal neglect or cruelty cases, and say to them, without this bill, do you think this is proper way to care for an animal? Are you comfortable with this in the state of Iowa? Leave that question with them. Let them go home and let them think about it. I found that starting to be a little helpful tactic I've added this year. And the other thing is to provide them with some regular updates. Again, another legislator from the central part of Iowa that I've known for quite a while, back in my museum days, she said to me, if you want me to really consider something, don't come to me in January. I am busy at the Capitol in January. I got a million things to do. I don't have time to really, really, really think about your issue, but talk to me when the session is over and we'll get it in the hopper for the next time around. So they're up there right now. They are scrambling. They are in meetings from sunup to sundown, it seems like, and then they come home on the weekend. They've got all kind of stuff to go to. They are really inundated. I'm not making excuses for any legislator, but their time is really short for everybody's issue. If you can get in the queue with them, if you can build that relationship in the off time, once January comes rolling around and you need to talk to them, and you can pick up the phone and say, hey, could you talk to me about this issue? They're prepared to visit with you about it. Being visible, there are a million ways to be visible, whether it's you take them out and one-on-one you sit down and have a cup of coffee with them. That's a real personal way to be visible with them. Going to a lobby day, going to a legislative forum. In fact, there was one in Scott County this morning. All 10 of our legislators were there, and the Iowa Friends for Companion Animals, Iowa Voters for Companion Animals group was there this morning. We go there every Saturday when there's a forum during the legislative session. We're actually a host of the legislative session this year, or a sponsor, so we have a booth there. And I've been told from a couple of my local elected officials that one of the reasons why the Iowa Voters group has made some headway in Scott County is because for the last 4 years, we've been consistent and we have been there all the time and we've been there in the yellow shirts. So whatever color shirt you're wearing, whatever color shirt your group has, if you can have that visual consistency and be there, you don't have to say anything, but being in the audience makes an impression on the legislators that are sitting there. Again, I think consideration of the office, whether you like the person or not, somebody said it earlier, they've won election, they're there representing us, you have to consider the fact that they're doing that, but also know that they're representing you and that's their job. I mentioned the off season is a very important time to visit with people. I love Lobby Day. It's a wonderful day to get together with all sorts of animal advocates from all over the state of Iowa. But in my estimation, Lobby Day is kind of the culmination of the 11 months prior to that. So when you, again, in my opinion, when you get to Lobby Day, it's kind of the icing on the cake. It's not baking the cake. Maybe you guys would have a different opinion of that, but I really think that's kind of the culmination of everything you've been working on. When they see you in the rotunda with your shirt and with your colleagues, they'll pay attention. But I think the most critical thing that I could share with you is the whole notion of emotion. What everybody has talked about this morning can really get a lot of emotions going. Neglected animals, killed animals, however you want to look at it, and the fact that we have such crappy laws in Iowa, all those things together really get people riled up. And while emotion can light our fire, it can't be the blaze. If you can kind of think about that for a minute. And I believe legislators, because they deal with so many different issues every day, they are very good at tuning out emotion. So you can rant, you can rave, you can stomp, you can do all that kind of stuff, and that is going to be tuned out very, very quickly. That's why you can circle back to that notion of building a relationship with a legislator. I think you can get past the emotional part. I would say that you want to let your emotional attachment to the issue be the engine that drives your passion to see the issue addressed. But don't let your emotion become the issue when you're either at the Capitol, having that cup of coffee, whatever the case may be. And I know that is really hard. It's probably one of the hardest things that we are going to do as advocates, whether it's an advocacy for an animal issue, for a death with dignity issue, with water quality issue. Any of those things are highly emotionally charged. But if you can be consistent, if you can diffuse the emotional potential a little bit by sitting across the table and having a cup of coffee with your legislator, you can do that a lot easier on that one-on-one than you can when you're up at the Capitol and they have all their colleagues around them, and they can, forgive me if there's anybody in the room who's an elected official, run for cover and hang out with your buds because you see the people in the yellow or the blue or the white shirts coming to talk to you about an issue that you're not crazy about. So that's what I would share with you. I hope it's helpful. I think you're all doing fantastic work, and I will echo what's already been said here. When you get that call to action from Iowa voters or the Humane Action Network, please respond to it. Time and time again, I have heard over the years from legislators, when they get five or six constituents contacting them on an issue, that's a big deal. Can you imagine what they would do if they got a dozen or if they got 20? So you don't have to be an expert in every little detail of every little bit of legislation. You can share your concern, you can share your passion, but most importantly, when these guys call and need your help, respond to it. And we'll get this done. We'll get it done in 2018 with everybody's help. So.
Well, I'm going to open it up to questions. I have some questions, so I can start. Or if there's anybody out there that would like to be asked first question, Lynn?
I wanted to know, a lot of times I've been told that if the representative or senator is not your representative or senator, they're just going to block you out. So I want to know your opinion about that. For example, if the bill is in the Judiciary Committee in the House, does it make sense to contact all the members on the Judiciary Committee, or is that a waste of time?
Tracy.
Well, I would say it probably wouldn't be the best use of your time to get a hold of everybody on that committee if you don't have a person sitting on that committee. However, your elected representative has friends on that committee. So never discount the fact that your particular person, senator or house person, might be a roommate with somebody who's on that committee. Or they have coffee with them, or they have breakfast with them, or they ride back and forth to Des Moines with them. Still talk to your particular representative or senator. Say, I understand so-and-so is on this committee. I know you're not. When you have that conversation with your colleague, would you please encourage them to support this bill that's coming out of their committee?
So even an email, it's like, don't email the people on the committee. I mean, it feels like such a little thing to contact your senator or representative. I mean, you know, that's only two people.
I know. But a lot of times if you do send that email, and I've gotten them back too, I'll get a message that says, thanks for contacting me. If you're not my constituent, I'm not going to respond
right
to you. So, you know, if it makes you feel good, go ahead and do it. But I would spend your time building that secondary relationship through your elected officials and ask them to do a little of your work for you when they go back to Des Moines.
I would say, to that point, I would focus on your elected officials, primarily that face-to-face and the phone calls. If it's an issue coming up that is very contentious, or even this legislation for anti-cruelty, you can send an email to the Judiciary Committee, because people outside of their district, they list on their email they're outside of their district, but they still have received that email. So the worst they can do is delete that. The best that they can take that into consideration and say, I've, you know, already heard from 5 people, even if they're kind of out of the district, an email wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. I wouldn't definitely phone and call if they're not your senator or representative. Kind of judge when you do that and don't do it consistently to irritate people. but it doesn't hurt. The situation we're at now, right, it's kind of a critical point in Iowa. So I think whatever we can do to move the needle forward for us.
Okay, other questions? Yeah, Bernie.
I'll just follow up on the point a couple of the speakers have made. legislative forums. Tracy mentioned the one in Scott County. Johnson County League of Women Voters does a, I think, monthly legislative forum. It's various locations around the county, but the next one is February 24th. It's right here in the Coral Hill Library. It may even be in this room for all I know. It's Saturday, 9:30 on the 24th. And it's a great opportunity to if you've never met your legislator, it's a good opportunity to introduce yourself, kind of let them know what you're interested in. And if there's usually a lot of people and questions are dominated by a handful of topics, but if you arrive early or stay late, it's a good opportunity to kind of buttonhole your senator or representative and introduce yourself and start to get to know them and build that relationship. I just want to make sure everybody's aware of that opportunity coming up.
Bernie? Okay, anybody else have a burning question? Yes.
Addressing hoarding, one of the ways to help legislators and law enforcement officials is, what is the definition of hoarding? I mean, how many animals, or is it a condition? And when you talk about psychological evaluation of hoarders, it's been shown that hoarders, that not animals, but other hoarders, are very, very difficult to treat, often not responsive to treatment at all. So what is the of psychological evaluation when nearly 100% are repeat offenders?
Well, the definition of hoarding, that's been batted around for a while. It actually is now recognized nationally as a psychological condition. I haven't looked at the MSDS manual lately, but kind of the working definition is when a person has a number of animals, excuse me, beyond which they are capable of routinely caring for, and are either unaware or unconcerned about their ability to care for the animals. Last I heard, it was considered to be more of an obsessive compulsive disorder. I think that was changing in the manual, but it's still being dealt with, but at least it's now recognized. And you're right, psychological counseling doesn't work in a lot of cases. But on the other hand, if we can get one person help with this, so we don't have to take, oh heavens, I think I had 8 cases around the state last year with over 100 cats at the home that I had to work around. And if we can fix one of those cases, that probably would be down to 7 cases a year. You know, so.
I'm going to put in a plug if you aren't aware. Dr. Randall Lockwood is going to be at the Animal Rescue League on the 13th of this month, right?
This month, 6th.
So it's Tuesday, and there's no charge for that presentation, right? If you haven't heard of Dr. Randall Lockwood, he is the expert on animal hoarding, and he's a great speaker. It's a wonderful presentation. You're going to have to drive to Des Moines, very, very worthwhile to go and see that presentation. It will really help you understand from a different perspective what hoarding is and how it needs to be treated.
Yeah, if I can just add, there is free finger food being provided. I'm just saying, Andy Cash Bar, but if you are going to attend, RSVP on our website, because they'd like to know how much food to prepare for this so that we don't have tons of food left over or people starving. So if you go to our website.
Go to the website, Animal Rescue League, and check that out. You can go. It is worthwhile. I don't know what else is new in his presentation, but I saw him years ago. It was probably one of the most valuable presentations I have ever seen on hoarding.
And he physically actually did write the book on animal hoarding with Tufts University. So he does know stuff.
It's a very, I've been told too. It's very cool.
Okay, other questions?
I have a question. All right. Offhand, you know, so for some of us who can't go to Des Moines on a Tuesday because we work, is there any possibility of having that, like,
he is with ASPCA, but they organize. However, ASPCA does have a lot of webinars on their website that you can, you know, log into and watch the webinar. I'm sure Dr. Lockwood is at least one or two of the webinars on there.
Okay. Who can just live stream it?
They have certain media restrictions, so the ASPCA is funding the presentation.
Yeah, Sherry.
Yeah, I just wondered, you were talking about those who are going to be against the bills of the Iowa Senate and the House. Are those mainly large corporation farmers? What is the...
What we're seeing, honestly, there's kind of a two-sided block that is working against this. The first one is Iowa Agriculture. As
Haley.
said, every time there's a piece of animal legislation, the agriculture block says slippery slope. In 2002, I think it was, first offense animal fighting was made a felony. They screamed, slippery slope, you'll get rid of all of our chickens if fighting birds is a felony. Agriculture survived it. In 2005, I remember the breakdown, but, you know, we got, you know, possession of exotic wild animals banned by individuals. We had people with tigers and corn cribs. And the agricultural block came out and said, oh, it's a slippery slope. You're going to take away the right to own tigers. Next thing you know, we can't own cows. Agriculture survived that. In 2007, the Pet Protection Act was put in place where you could add household pets to a protection order in a domestic abuse situation. Because a lot of victims were staying in the situation to protect the pets. We heard, oh, well, they'll do that to their livestock herd, and it'll shut down livestock, it's a slippery slope. It didn't happen. We hear this year after year, it's a knee-jerk reaction by the agricultural bloc that any animal welfare law is going to shut down Iowa agriculture. It has not happened since I have lived in Iowa. But they keep saying, the other side is the Iowa pet breeders. The ones who are running commercial breeding operations, they don't want to see increased activity on animal welfare laws. They're satisfied with, as Haley said, the survival level care requirements under the USDA and the Iowa Department of Agriculture. They don't want to see more standards. And they, you know, they'll sit there and agree with anything agriculture says. Agriculture will work with them and agree with whatever they say. So we've got those two big blocks that are really fighting. I really think the average citizen in Iowa doesn't have a problem with making torturing an animal a first offense felony. I really don't. I think they want to see animals with actual dog or cat food, not the corn casserole from last night, you know, for their dinner. Water that doesn't have gunk in it. I think the average Iowan wants that. But it's special interest groups, you know, that have something to lose apparently that are fighting it.
Yeah,
so Senate File 2181. Two questions. One is, what is, do you think the chance of it's actually going to pass? I understand the other one is dead in the water. But, and the other question, so as on that bill, is there something in there that would prevent people from owning animals again if they get convicted?
Yes. First of all, possibilities of passage. We are so much further along this year than we have ever been. Part of that has been political juggling. Years past, it's been in the Judiciary Committee, in the Senate side, and the House did in the Agriculture. Throwing any animal welfare bill into the Agricultural Committee kills it. This year on the House side, it got put in the Judiciary. It's a law enforcement issue. And it's made it through the House Judiciary Subcommittee, and it's now calendared for the House Judiciary Committee. So we're a lot further along than we have been, and we've got a lot better chance of getting it through to the floor. As far as future ownership, that was your question, right? There are provisions in SF 2181 and HSB 608 that say for certain crimes, a judge must put a two-year ban on contact or ownership of companion animals in these cases, and must, in the more heinous crimes, put a 10-year ban on ownership or contact with companion animals. Otherwise, the judge in both bills may do it. But he isn't required to. But in those cases where you abuse an animal to the point where it dies, you torture an animal, it needs to be put in there that it has to be done.
And how are you going to know if they have animals again? Will there be follow-up that someone would go inspect their premises? I mean, how do you know if they get animals again?
that would be a law enforcement question because it will be a condition of sentencing, just as, you know, you can't drive for 5 years because you've been caught drunk driving 47 times this year. Law enforcement will have to keep an eye on it, you know, but at least the tool will be there in place to keep it from happening.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, what? One more question.
Okay, sorry. What? Why do judges not give people higher sentences even now when they can? Why do they just give them a little slap on the wrist? Do they just think animals don't count?
Sure, because in most of those cases, it's probably going to be a plea that was agreed to by the prosecutor and the defense attorney, and typically the judges will go along with what the plea was. So if you would have had a prosecutor that said, hey, we will let you off the hook if you would just plead it, and the judge would just follow along with that.
Well, in Johnson County, the case where that guy abused this kitten for like 2 hours, it was just heinous what this guy did. The prosecutor, they tried for the maximum, and the judge gave them almost nothing. So I just wondered if it's like a societal attitude, or these judges' attitude towards animals?
It's just, I wouldn't
I'm
say...
I'm a retired judge.
Oh.
And I've been dealing with, I've been retired now for 10 years, but I've dealt with animal cases, and they're complicated. You know, I mean, people do horrendous things. The animal torture cases are likely to be handled with some intensity from the bench. I also, years and years ago, I had horses shot by a juvenile who was maybe 12 years old, 11 years old, had been left home, he had been sick, he got a .22 rifle for Christmas, and he went out and he shot the neighbor's horses, basically, because nobody had really taken the time to teach him about a .22 rifle. And he had no idea that it would travel that far and it would actually hit these horses. And there was, you know, people were outraged about it, and I took some heat for it because basically it ended up being a good resolution. He worked with the farmer. The farmer worked with him and helped him to learn about horses and to learn about the care of them. He was very remorseful. In every other aspect of his life, he was a sensitive, caring young man. And
he's not a serial killer today?
Not, okay. Not.
Well,
but I've had the other cases where they have been serial.
Sure.
And the animal torture cases.
Many of them don't end up. But, you know, the mental health treatment and addressing those issues is really critical. Now, I have a couple of questions that were sent to me by people who couldn't be here. So, Lynn,
can I ask two questions real quick?
Yes. Yeah.
So, I think maybe, Scott, you can probably speak to this the best, but what's happening legally on the federal level for animal welfare issues, and is there anything that we can do here or anybody we can contact with our federal legislators? And the second question has to do with who are the state legislators that have introduced these laws in both the House and the Senate, and who can we thank? Is there somebody that we as a group can thank or send out if there are legislators?
Oh, the second question is going to be tough for me because all legislators look the same. I know it's biased, but it's true. Your first question, the federal laws, part of the problem with that is in order to have any sort of federal legislation, it's either got to deal with interstate commerce or interstate transport. So there aren't a lot of animal cruelty laws per se that aren't more effectively dealt with at the state level. There are a couple. Animal fighting, interstate commerce of animals for fighting is a federal offense. I'll use the term I hated because it's really disgusting. Crush videos, if you're familiar with them, are usually produced in one place, but they're distributed through internet or mail to a variety of states. That's covered federally. Those are the sorts of crimes that are really dealt with at the federal level. As far as animal cruelty here in Iowa, as long as it happens in Iowa and stays in Iowa, usually the most effective mechanism for dealing with it is Iowa law. You know.
Was there some legislation introduced, though, federally that had to do with USDA licensed facilities this year?
Well, there was the PUPS bill that was, I don't know where that went.
And I'll be, I think Bernie's trying to raise his hand to say something, so I'll defer to him.
Just a couple things to follow up. As far as federal legislation, one of the better places to go check, in my opinion anyway, is ASPCA.org. They have an advocacy page that has, because they're a national organization, it tends to focus more on national issues. So you'll, so there's material on there about this PUPS bill, and there's also, it's called the SAFE Act, Safeguard American Food Exports, which is really a horse slaughter ban bill that's been offered the last several sessions, so there's material on there about that, and a handful of other bills. We're kind of working to kind of put some of that material on our ARL Humane Action Network page as well, but we've had more of a Iowa focus on the things that are immediately kind of in front of us, but it's something on the to-do list, so to speak.
Do you know if the PUPS bill has gone anywhere at this point?
A lot of those bills, for the most part, they've been introduced by a congressman and or a senator, and so they kind of sit there and they work among their colleagues to try to collect co-sponsors for the bill. And kind of the logic is, if you get a critical mass of co-sponsors on a bill, then there's more of an incentive to move it through a committee assignment and stuff like that. So, you know, that's, if you check out that information through ASPCA.org, it'll probably give you a good little synopsis of where it stands currently. As far as your other question was about the legislators.
Just the state level, as far as the House and the Senate bills, for both of the bills, is there anyone that, who introduced those on the both the House and the Senate side, and are they anybody that people in this room might have
right,
as
on,
their legislator?
On the House side, it was introduced by Senator Zach Nunn, who's in Polk County.
Okay.
He's the chair of the House Judiciary Committee, which is, and he's a Republican, so he's in the majority. So he's a great advocate to have on that bill because he can kind of help guide it through the Judiciary Committee, hopefully. And he's also in the majority party, so he's got more swing than somebody in the minority party that would be sponsoring a bill. On the Senate side, similar thing, House, or Senate File 2181, I think it is now, was originally introduced by Senator Brad Zahn, who's also a Polk County Senator, but he's also chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, so he's got the same kind of ability to kind of help guide it through that process. On the Senate side, it's through the full Judiciary Committee, passed on a vote of 8-4. If you go check out our ARL Humane Action Network Facebook page, if you look back a little bit, you'll find a post that kind of talks about that committee vote and lists who voted for and against. I can't remember if there's anybody from the Johnson County area that vote. Okay, thanks, Liz. But that bill's eligible for a vote of the full Senate, so it's perfectly valid to for everybody to contact their state senator and ask them to support this bill because its next stop is a floor vote in the Senate.
Was Representative Kaufman involved in introducing that on the House side?
He was not, because it was introduced through the Judiciary Committee as a House study bill, which is a little bit of a nuance over a regular House file. But Representative Kaufman has certainly been a great advocate in previous years for these kinds of issues. Yeah, and so he's been a good advocate.
He was a yay.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
He was a yay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Those of you who don't know, Bernie Letty, he's back there, the font of information. He's on the ARL Board of Directors.
I am.
And he's been working very closely with our key management, developing these legislative bills, you know, for submission to be reviewed by the legislators. He has been studying all these issues with us. He is, like I said, a true font of knowledge. So good to have him here.
Scott does
so
hold
I
up.
Want to follow up on that with, because a couple of people have mentioned the ARL, the Humane Action Alert, and that part of the website. And that, from someone who gets like 100 to 200 emails every day, I can't stand it when I get junk mail. That is a very valuable email to get, and they don't blast out something to you every other day. They will send you emails when they're important. And I would say the same thing about Iowa voters. You know, they send you something when it's really important. So if you want to stay in tune with what's happening with these bills and in the state, definitely check out the Humane Action Alerts. And that's where you find other opportunities to learn about other animal welfare subjects, such as, you know, that Randall Lockwood thing was posted on the last Humane Action Alert, I think down at the bottom. ask a couple of questions that were like burning from the crowd, but I'm not sure if they're going to get asked. So, how come an animal shelter can't just go and take animals away when cruelty is clearly evident?
Well, it's real simple. We have, for the most part, unless it's a local city contract or a county contract, absolutely no law enforcement power. And there are a lot of people on social media who advocate, will go at night and steal the animal. And that's great advice if you want to win the battle, but you will lose the war. I hate to say it, animal welfare is a long-term mission in the state. So with my position, I'm lucky. I've been working with law enforcement for 26 years in one form or another, so I speak cop. And it's an easy language to speak, but a lot of people, especially if they get emotional about the animal welfare subject, don't speak it well. I will be honest, I have had some activists call up sheriff's offices about something, and basically the conversation went, get off your donut-dunking butt and do your job. That does not endear you to law enforcement. We had a county in southwestern Iowa where a dog was outside, had terrible shelter, but it had shelter under Iowa code. So a Facebook storm started. They were getting phone calls on the 911 system from Germany and Australia. What happened was it shut down their 911 system in the county for 3 days, which meant no ambulance calls, no fire calls, nothing. This does not endear you to law enforcement. When you call them, you have to speak with them with a degree of respect. You explain, you know, this is the issue, can you check it out? Can I get a call back about so I can, you know, put my mind at ease and everything's checked out? Personally, I work with law enforcement, giving them the expertise, because I feel sorry for county sheriff's offices. The deputies and sheriff are expected to know everything from jaywalking to homicide, and there's usually, on the smaller counties, 3 or 4 deputies, if you're lucky. And you throw them into an animal welfare issue, it's really a specialized area of law enforcement, and they're in over their head on from the beginning. So that's why I, you know, get a call, I call them and say, here's the situation, here's what the law says, what can I do to help you? You catch a lot more flies with honey than you do with a baseball bat. Really. But, yeah, back to the question, though. Most shelters don't have any sort of law enforcement ability. That's why the first call should always be to law enforcement in the local jurisdiction. Even if you've had bad experiences with them in the past, call them, because they're the ones who are going to have to take action. After
there's,
that,
there's two parties that can remove animals, right? Law enforcement and veterinarians, and they have to come together, generally speaking, right? You can call your veterinarian, tell them that they've got a problem, they choose to go or not go. They need to be, they generally would obviously call law enforcement in that case. But I have no powers of going on anyone's property, nor would I do that when you're dealing with situations that are tough, that are very emotional, that it's not smart, right? I want to live tomorrow. And people are just insane when it comes to animal situations. The only two people, agencies that can remove animals from any situation in Iowa, be it horse or small animal, is a veterinarian and law enforcement. That's it.
And I will say, Shovak, how many of you work with a local shelter or volunteer with a local shelter in the state? How many of you have bothered to meet your sheriff or police? Guess what? They kept calling us, and I really hate driving to Sioux City to pick up a bunch of animals when there's a shelter right there that can work with them. It really is a waste of resources and time. And like I said, last year we had, I think, 8 cases with over 100 cats. We may be a big shelter. We can't take in that many cats. We need local resources stepping up to help. So if you work for a local shelter, get to know your local law enforcement. Let them know you're a resource. You can train them on animal welfare issues. You don't need to be an expert. You can go online and say, here's the Tufts Animal Care and Condition Scoring System. You know, this one says dog emaciated. This one says dog healthy. This is what is used by everyone to judge if a dog's neglected. Teach them about that stuff. Teach them what good food is and good water. Tell them why that cardboard box next to the tree is not sheltered 20 below weather. You've got to work with local law enforcement. I mean, we're always there to help out, but we're only one organization.
What did you say it was? The Tusk Animal
Care and Condition Scoring. warning system. It was developed by Tufts University several years ago. But it breaks animal care scoring into four sections. Physical care, basically how skinny the dog is, and this is just recognized for dogs. The weather care, if you have a English bulldog with a blunt nose out in 100 degree weather, it's a severe situation. If you have a Chihuahua out in 100 degree weather, it might not be quite so severe. The care scale, if the dog's mad to the point where they have sores underneath the fur, and the environmental care, if there's feces everywhere, if there's broken wire everywhere. All four of those scales are used to determine what level of neglect is happening and what sort of action needs to be taken. And it's available online.
All right, Devin, this one's for you. Why can't law enforcement do anything about pet store puppies getting sick as soon as people buy them and take them home?
Well, because, you know, for the most part, that's going to be what's called a civil issue. You know, if you go and you buy a product, which is what the dog is, the puppy is, and if that puppy is sick or worse, that's an issue between you and that business owner. That's a civil issue. You know, if a store had potentially enough cases of this that it was actively getting into a fraudulent situation, the state may step into that and look at kind of state remedies to it. But again, for the most part, it's no different than you going and buying a chair. The chair gets home and it breaks. That's you and the business owner.
So if you purchase a puppy and it's defective, who do you report that to?
You could try to offer it back to the pet store. Usually they will have some kind of process. You have to use their vet. Their vet will look it over, will then kind of give you an assessment. Again, they're paying the vet, so you can imagine how those assessments typically go. But the biggest issue I was saying is that people have typically then already become attached to that little right? Nobody wants to give the sick puppy back because now, that's your dog. So you can report it to the pet store, but that's really, you can call the police, but they're going to say, have you called the pet store?
And so if you're talking in terms of a store, getting a lot of complaints or complaints racking up about that, that's where I was going with the second part of the question is, how would you know that? Who would you report that to?
You could try iDolls or the Consumer Protection Division of the Attorney General's Office here in Iowa. I've sent people there before, and they will make a record of it. But for the most part, a layperson, we can Google it, there's that option. And some of the bigger names, you can just Google them and you'll find out all the horror stories. But, you got to kind of do your research in advance and go from there.
Also, the Better Business Bureau of Iowa, they keep track, they have nice, chat sections on various businesses that have gotten complaints. And people do check that, and when you hit these breeders or pet stores in the pocketbook, things change. They're there to make money, and if they have 40 complaints about selling sick dogs, and they're not now selling any dogs, they're either going to go out of business or they're going to fix the problem.
Okay, so there were also lots of questions about the legislation in California. Can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
So California passed AB 485, which basically makes it illegal for a pet store to sell a dog, cat, or rabbit that is not sourced from a shelter, humane society, or the like. So it's really great news. It's really great legislation. It's the first statewide legislation for something like that. We have more than 200 similar ordinances throughout the country, but that was the first statewide legislation. What it did not do is it did not ban puppy mills, it did not ban online sales, it did not ban going to a breeder. So it was a great step. Here in Iowa, it's great for us because it took out one of those distribution kind of networks for us. A lot of the puppies born in Iowa are actually exported. They don't stay in Iowa. So as you saw that CBI that I showed you, that puppy went to California. So if that puppy were going to a pet store, that would no longer be happening. And that starts January of 2019.
Other questions before
I go on?
Anybody else here? Yeah, go ahead.
Given that there's been at least one state that has said that ag gag is unconstitutional, are there any plans to try to mount a challenge to our own ag gag rule here in Iowa?
Yes. I will say, though, Iowa's ag gag was originally proposed. It was going to be grossly unconstitutional, and they knew that. So they worked with the Attorney General's office to redraft it in a way that would pass, they think, would pass constitutional muster. The way that it's written in Iowa compared with other states is, we think of ag news, you can't go and you can't film on the property, you can't. Iowa's, it's really focused on false statements during the application process. So you can't, they made it illegal to lie on your application to go work at an animal facility if your intention is to film it or do something else not allowed by the owner. So that it's different than what a lot of the other AAA states were, and specifically worked with the attorneys to, but it, there is talk of that happening.
Okay. Other questions? Yeah. So I know that the agricultural sector has been a block against a lot of the companion animal reforms, but as a proponent of changes to the agricultural sector's animal welfare policies, I would love to see changes there as well. And so I sometimes see that the two sectors are kind of against each other, because it's like we don't want to offend the agricultural sector with our companion animal welfare policies, but at the same time, as someone who thinks that the agricultural sector needs to change too, I wish the two could come together to fight for animal welfare for all animals. But I understand it's sometimes seen as harder because of that big block, so I'm curious to know any thoughts on that.
Well, I would say this. Iowa State University has hired in the last 5 years some veterinarians from abroad and has really opened up the agricultural end of things. If you look at your Farm Bureau ads these days, they're going to pigs and chickens and they're saying how they treat their animals. It is so important how they're treating their ag animals. And they're really, in my opinion, and I've watched this for 12 years, 13 years, they seem to be, Iowa State anyways, which is your ag, you know, guru in my opinion, seem to be trying to make it a little bit more out there. You know, that even if you are a hog farmer, or you're a chicken, or whatever they're called, you know, that they really, I give them credit, I really do. I've been on a few rescues with them on inspections and that sort of things, and they seem to be a little bit more open. I don't know, what do you think, Scott?
Well, I agree. Actually, a cooperative effort between Iowa State University and the Iowa Farm Bureau was the Iowa Farm Animal Care Committee.
Yes.
And basically what they do is they get complaints from production facilities that are having problems. They will go out and visit with the owner of the production facility, discuss proper animal husbandry care, discuss the complaints, and try to find ways to alleviate the problem that's been complained about. And if they can't do that, they will also work with law enforcement if necessary. Correct problems legally. But you're right, I would love to see both Iowa Code 717 and 717B dealt with, you know, at some point. Unfortunately, changing Iowa welfare laws is very labor and resource intensive, and we've got to pick our battles, and right now, for the last 5 years, the battle has been companion animals, you know, so hopefully if we can get this passed this year, we can circle back around and start looking at the agricultural section.
Yeah, so this is what, you know, Tracy was talking about earlier, that it really takes being persistent and being consistent, right? And I think that where we are today with 2181 is because, you know, the Animal Rescue League really has been a driving force and a lot of other support consistently for years. But what they figured out, and Bernie, maybe you can add to this, is that they had to divide the issues in order to push the companion animals and get them where they are today.
Yeah, I mean, it's a tough battle, even, like we've been talking about, it's a tough battle even with a bill that is limited to companion animals, because you get that slippery slope argument. And one thing that I would want to highlight to everybody here in that regard is Iowa's really kind of, maybe not unique, but one of only a few states they're really kind of right in the code, has built in a firewall between agriculture animals and companion animals. So chapter 717 covers injured livestock, 717B is injured non-livestock animals. And in a way, that there's a positive aspect to that from the standpoint that it really is a tool to knock down that slippery slope argument, because there are two separate sections in the code. There's a firewall between non-livestock animals and livestock animals. I get your point, but at the same time, it ought to be virtually impossible for ag interests to make that slippery slope argument, because the code is structured the way it is, and most states don't have that. It's all together.
Okay. Tracy.
Yes?
What's the most important thing we need to leave this room with?
I'll go back to that whole notion about emotion. Try to keep it in check. I know it's tough. I know you want to do what you can for the animals, but do it in a way that is calm if you can, data-driven, keep the emotion in check.
All right. Well, I'm pretty proud to be a part of this community, so thanks for coming.
Hey, Liz.
Yes.
Can I just can I just introduce myself? I'm Lynn Snyder, and I'm part of the Iowa Friends for Companion Animals. We have a local team. If anyone's interested in joining us in our effort locally here in the Cedar Rapids, Iowa City area, we'd be happy to have you. So you can either see me or contact Liz, and she'll get you hooked up with me.
Are there any other advocacy teams?